Do you
talk a
go
little
to
bit.
For You or Following? My head's like in a pretzel. I get on Twitter now and I don't know which, like,
I do both.
it's annoying to me though. I
I
don't
know.
like, what's the point of that? It's Thursday, January 24th. I can't believe it's January 24th. Like, where did January go? This is episode 252 of the Token CEO podcast. I'm Erica. I'm the CEO of Barstool Sports. And we part-time in the podcast business with this show. We have an awesome episode today. We've got Steve Krakauer. Steve is one of my good friends. I actually met him. He's like an internet friend. You know when you have like an internet friend, which is someone you follow and then you like tweet at each other. We've talked a bunch over Zoom. He was in New York City, so he came in and will be part of our boardroom where he's talking about what he sees happening at the New York Times, CNN, Puck, Semaphore, all the Barry Weiss, all the niche or what he would call vibe media companies, which is kind of an interesting concept. We have Q&A, and then that's about it for this episode. So I feel like that's enough. Everyone's busy. Everyone's like, I'm like falling off my resolutions, or I have a list and I didn't get to it yet. That's how I feel anyways. Before we get into it though, let's say a big thank you to Omega Accounting Solutions. Omega Accounting Solutions offers a whole bunch of services for small businesses. What's incredible about that is they have a whole team of analysts and accountants and account managers. So they've got a whole bunch of people inside of their walls whose only job and mission in life is to support small businesses. The reason this is important is small business owners are busy running their business, not busy thinking about being an accountant or their accounting or their finances or frankly tax law. What's awesome and about to end soon is that if you are a small business owner and you employed people during COVID, you are eligible for up to $26,000 per employee in tax credits. Omega knows all about this, and all you have to do is to fill out a quick survey or have a 10-minute phone call, and they can help you understand if you're eligible. So you can call 800-309-ERC. That's 800-309-ERC. Or visit omegataxcredits.com/barstoolsports now. All right, so we'll kick it to Steve. Steve was here bright and early this morning. I like hardly had my eyes open. But we'll kick it to Steve, and he's going to tell us what's happening in the media world. He also has written a book called Uncovered, which I have here. Uncovered is how the media got cozy with power, abandoned its principles, and lost the people. Great subtitle. It comes out on February 24th. You can pre-order it now. You can also subscribe to Steve's The Fourth Watch, which is his newsletter, or you can watch The Megyn Kelly Show, which he produces. But we have a quick and interesting conversation on media, and we'll go to that now. Okay, so I've got Steve Krakauer with me. Steve is one of my favorite people in media. I was going to say favorite. You kind of are one of, besides the homegrown favorites here. Right. But what I love about Steve is that you write pretty consistently and constantly about media, the changes in media, in particular traditional media, news media. You've just written a book, which will come out at the end of February.
Yes, yeah, about a month. Yeah.
Called Uncovered, which anybody should read, and we'll have Steve back on to talk about that at the end of the month. But let's go through, like, what are you seeing happening in media right now? Like, you've got CNN, you've got David Zaslav taking $300 billion out of, you know, the conglomerate. What's your take on, like, what's next for CNN?
Yeah, that's a big story. I mean, I think it's a big story for anyone, but it's certainly for me as someone who was at CNN for several years.
Yeah.
David Zaslav, you know, at the very top, Chris Licht underneath him. And there are two people that I know a little bit.
I feel like Chris Licht must be like, I hope they're paying him an ungodly amount of money because he must be like, my job sucks.
I think he
wants power. In that case, it's a good job.
And I think you go into that thinking this is a long-term fix. I mean, you know, the elephant in the room is, you know, Donald Trump is running again. You know, this is going to be a giant election cycle, 2023, 2024. I mean, this is just beginning. And any of these like little fixes that he's trying to do, I mean, right now it's kind of rearranging the talent that's already there in new combinations. I can't imagine that's really the long-term plan.
Yeah.
So I'm very curious about it. Look, Chris came in and with a mandate from David Zaslav to put news back in at CNN.
Okay.
And they've drifted so far away during the Trump era. They started just you know, letting their anchors literally do monologues on every hour. I mean, they actually had names for it. They called them Murrows, where the anchor was just allowed, okay, now's your time to do a monologue. Like, that's not CNN.
Yeah.
And so you now, how do you do news again, build an, that audience, build that trust back up.
How to get people to trust you for the news and to watch news on television.
Yeah, and
that's
to make
a
it interesting, yeah. Right? Because that's also the challenge. That's part of why I think Jeff Zucker, who I worked with, and I like Jeff, and he's, you know, he knows that it can't be boring either.
Yeah.
And so how do you put news back in, establish that trust, and make it interesting and entertaining? I think it's a big challenge, but I like Chris. You know, Chris has been successful at Morning Joe, at CBS This Morning, and then at Colbert. Did a good job.
Clearly understands media.
And then it's like, well, how do you match that content with the business side of it? Which is, the business challenges are tough for every media outlet, but particularly CNN, which I think is in a little bit of a perilous position. So I'm anxiously watching. I think I hope that it works, because I think we need a CNN that people trust. But it's a tough gig, for sure.
So, and then what do you think about, like, Puck? And, you know, what do you think about some of... So, we were having this conversation earlier. Like, you're funny in that you're actually just reporting on things versus trying to build a mega brand. Like, if you look at... So, you look at Semaphore, and then you've got Puck. Like, Puck reminds me of All Things D when... Kara Swisher was just obsessed. I worked for Yahoo, and Kara Swisher was just like obsessively reporting on what was happening at Yahoo. And you read it to find out what was happening at work the day you went into work. And I feel like Puck has a little bit of that obsession with CNN. But what do you think about the rise of, I don't even know what you would call these.
Yeah.
What do you call them?
It's hard. I mean, you think of it, I guess, as subscription-based, you know, media outlets that are not single person, like a Substack, but are trying to do something
that are highly curated. It's
highly
like we
curated.
Have a point of view.
Yeah, and by design, they want to not have a giant audience.
Yeah.
You know, they don't need a giant audience.
Yeah, they're
audience.
Like narrow and deep.
Right. You want to get the people, and Puck is interesting because they make it very plainly clear. We're writing for the people in power. You know, they're like
elite people. We're going to write for you.
Exactly.
Which is funny, but it's not a bad strategy.
It's not a bad strategy. You know, if you can get your company the expense account to pay for the subscription, I have to say I'm a subscriber to Puck.
I'm 100% subscribed. I think they should get into the conference business. They'll run a good conference business.
Yeah, that makes sense. Events and things. So I've been kind of toying with the phrase, because I see a lot of what you're saying with Puck also, where kind of like vibes journalism. Like,
oh, is that what it... Okay.
I'm just throwing this around. Like, so I you know, a reporter talks to some people inside, and then just like without quoting anyone, just kind of giving a, here's the vibes of what's going on at this organization.
Interesting.
It's almost opinion disguised as journalism, but it's more of just like, this is what's happening. I know what's happening.
I don't think it's journalism.
No,
do you?
No, it's not.
I think it's like gossip and intrigue and speculation.
Right. But if you couch it as, I talked to a dozen people at this outlet and this is what's happening.
Yeah, you're right about the vibe. You're like, this is kind of...
Yeah, like I know what's happening here.
Yeah.
You don't have to quote anyone. It's not even like Page Six where you like throw an anonymous source quote.
Yeah.
It's just like a general, like, we know this industry really well, so we're going to tell you what's happening.
Here's what you should be thinking about.
Yeah, and I think that's pretty bad. I mean, that's not like a good form of journalism, but it's interesting. Mm-hmm. It's buzzy. It gets
it's
that
kind
nice
of magazines. It's,
yeah.
It's that kind of editorial.
And Matt Bellany and Dylan Byers, they've broken some stories,
you
know, and so I think that's where you go with it. Ben Smith, you know, and Semaphore have a little bit of a different strategy. I mean, they're a giant outlet. I believe they hired 50, 60 people at the outset.
I don't know how they can afford to do that.
They got a bunch of funding early on.
That's not going to go well.
No, and it's free right now. I mean, there's not a paid product for them.
I heard one of their writers had a freak out about a sponsor. Did you hear about
this? Yes.
Like, I wrote about this once.
It's an interesting story. This is a guy who was covering like climate for them and then had Chevron attached on as a sponsor on all of it. You know, of course, Chevron's like, we're, you know, doing our best.
We're
to
clean energy.
The, right, you know,
we didn't destroy the planet for hundreds of years.
But, you know, they're trying to push that storyline there. I've heard that there was a little bit more attention
to the story.
Yes.
Then.
But yes, that was certainly the story he said when he exited there. Forced to or on his own,
that's what's hard though, is that like you want to be uncompromising, obviously, editorially, but then you're like, you got to make money, and who wants to advertise to elite people? It's people who've done bad things and need to change people's mind about them,
right? Exactly. How do you try to, you know, sanitize that laundry reputation? You put that on the top of a climate story,
exactly, which I think all these businesses are going to have. Like, there's going to be an inherent, you know, who wants to reach elite groups of influential people who need to lobby for things.
Right.
And that, you know, that piece is interesting. Okay, so you've got Semaphore is free, Puck you pay for, You've got my girl Barry, who's, you know, going to build
the free
a
press.
Juggernaut. Yep. Mm-hmm. Who else is in that orbit, do you think? Well, are you guys in that orbit?
Megyn Kelly? I don't know, because we're not necessarily, you know, Megyn Kelly's show is you know, owned by Sirius right now, or is, you know, under the Sirius XM umbrella. It's a live radio show every day, but also podcast and YouTube. But it's really just an independent product. You know, it's not a full-on
brand. It's not a media company.
Yeah, and that's where I actually think Barry is going to be an interesting one to watch. You know, Barry's got a few employees right now. I mean, she's done great work on her own. But Barry, you know, I always think of, like, is she talent or management? I think about this with a lot of people. Yeah. She's kind of in the middle, but she's talent, you know.
Definitely.
But she, I think, at her core is an editor. You know, she's not trying to be the star of
I can edit the shit out of anyone and make them great.
And she does.
And she can.
Yes, yeah, exactly. And I have to say, like, you know, we talk about a place like Semaphore and there's some of the challenges of how do you build this new brand when I think authenticity is a huge aspect of the challenges that a company like that faces. Barry so far has that, you know, that authenticity. I think obviously, you know, it's what makes Barstool.
Yeah.
Barstool is like, you trust it that these people are saying
real.
Exactly right.
Yeah,
exactly what
real.
They think. And it's a little bit of a challenge, I think, with places like Semaphore or even, to be honest, places like Puck, which, you know, these people have great sources, but how compromised are they with in the industry that they're covering?
Yeah,
they're so inside of it. Barry, you know, I mean, she got out of the New York Times and
made
Barry's
waves. Independent, truly independent. Speaking of the New York Times, what do you think's happening at the New York Times?
Like,
everyone at New York Times is miserable, right? Like, if you work at the New York Times, you're like miserable.
I know, they just had their big walkout. Right.
But did anything change?
I don't know. I don't think so. It seems like there's a lot of tension there. I will say the New York Times may be in slightly better position than the Washington Post, which is really, like, everything you hear out of there is just miserable. I know Jeff Bezos was just there last week. And
They like pitching stories on him
to him? About him and talking about the layoffs.
They're all negative. Yeah.
I mean, it's,
that's interesting that you think Washington Post is in a worse spot.
I do,
From an editorial perspective or a business perspective?
Both, I think, I mean, look, I think the New York Times...
Well, they built that subscription business.
Yes, the business is doing well. And every, I would say multiple times a week, I find something really well done and interesting coming out of the New York Times. Mm-hmm. I mean, I find a lot of, like, things that are junk and are, you know, spin and you know,
opinion,
just total
couch,
propaganda.
Just turn,
yes, but they also have some good journalism. Yeah. It's a giant outlet. Yeah. The Washington Post is a little bit more iffy. I mean, they do some good journalism also, but they, even more so than the New York Times, I think, bought into that Trump era of, you know, just full on in. Like, you look at some of the other outlets, like, you know, Vice is struggling and Vox is doing cuts.
Yeah.
You know, these are, it's the shift. I mean, look, it's a tough time for everyone, I think, in the media outlet, and talk about the advertising that's sort of drying up. But I look at the Washington Post, the fact that they're owned by Jeff Bezos is complicated, and it's only going to get more complicated the more the business starts to shrink and people start to flail. There's, you know, reports that they're looking at selling some of these technology arms that they started to build up that didn't seem to really pan out. So I'm a little bit more bullish on the New York Times than the Washington Post, even if there is, like, always, I mean,
strife.
Yes, yeah. I mean, just the Slack channels are on fire.
Yeah, that's,
you know,
right.
And that's just like
the nature of the beast.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, and then what's your read on Fox?
Yeah, I mean, Fox is in another interesting spot. I think, you know, this is more of a political one, but excuse me. At some point, you know, Tucker Carlson, Sean Hannity, you know, all their biggest stars are going to have to kind of make a I don't want to say pick a side, but we're going to get the Trump, the DeSantis, whoever else is involved. And I've written before, I almost think an outlet like a CNN or an MSNBC wants Trump to be the nominee more than Fox does.
Because they need the views?
Yeah, I mean, it's great for business.
Yeah.
And from Fox's perspective, it's like he's so tainted, and yet he's still very popular.
Yeah.
And they are, you know, they gotten a lot of kind of like, it was a little bit touchy there after the election when they declared that Trump lost.
Right.
And they got some backlash and the churn of the audience. I mean, they did come back. But I think, look, the business is great at Fox News. Like, it's crushing it.
Yeah.
The 2022 ratings, CNN and MSNBC, the lowest ratings of all time. Fox, down slightly year over year.
Okay.
Very small. So they're doing well from the content side and from the business side. But the audience, you know, what happens during this primary cycle, it's going to be a tightrope for them, I think. And it's going to be one to watch. I mean, I'm a big Tucker Carlson fan. I like it because I don't know what he's going to say. And I'm still waiting for that day when we get into that cycle and he has some, you know, harsh words. In my book, he has kind of some harsh words for Trump and just kind of the Trump era. I'd be very curious to see what he does, but he's very different than Sean Hannity and Laura Ingraham, and that's what's interesting about
Fox. I'm
surprised
that Tucker hasn't gone out on his own.
Yeah, although, you know, they've been good to him there.
I'm
sure. He's doing, obviously, his 8 p.m. show, but he also has all these documentaries that he puts on Fox Nation. He does the long-form
interviews.
The End
of Men. That was my favorite. I literally was on a flight to Utah. This is when you know where you are in the country. I was on a flight to Utah, and Tucker Carlson, I guess, has this documentary, which was called The End of Men, which is just so Tucker Carlson, it hurts. But smart, just smart. But every screen was like an old white man with that play. It was so interesting. I was like, this is interesting.
I mean, he takes these topics. This is the end of men. He understands. Sperm counts that are falling around the world. And what's the reason for that? And it's chemicals. I mean, it's actually kind of an interesting topic. We talked about it a little bit on the Meg Kelly show.
It's funny.
No, he's an interesting, like, very unique.
He's a
media
smart
figure.
Media cat. Yeah. I also then was reading that I think Rachel Maddow did something in Vanity Fair. There was a Vanity Fair piece on her. Mm-hmm. And then I was kind of like, God, they kind of like look alike. Like they might actually be the same person in some like crazy different world. It could be.
Yeah. Well, listen, Tucker gave Rachel her start on MSNBC, which is amazing. I mean, you look at the early Tucker MSNBC shows from like 2008, 2009. He was the first person to put Rachel on the air. They still are friendly. I think in the Vanity Fair piece, she talks about them being friends. But there is some similarity.
They're kind of like, if you look quick, you know what I mean?
And they're both like hugely successful like TV talents. Yeah. I mean, just pure entertainers like and singular. You know, that's what, they're like unicorns.
I mean, it's hard to find and raise those people.
Right.
And then what do you think's happening with ESPN? Is Disney going to sell ESPN? You think ESPN gets into gambling? Like, what's your take?
Gambling seems, I think, like inevitable, right? Yeah. I mean, it already is
everywhere else
for them, right? And they're trying to, I think, incorporate that more. I'd be shocked if Disney sold ESPN. It feels like, what are the things that bring people to linear television right now? It's live sports still. And you know, we're at ESPN, I know that there's the NBA rights deals coming up. There's, you know, obviously NFL, it just happened. So I could see ESPN being a real cog for Disney longer term. You know, what does Disney do on the streaming side? I mean, but it's also a business that's just in peril.
You know, for sure.
And that's what's going to be one to watch.
Are you following the Dana White UFC thing with them?
Yeah.
What do you think about that?
With them?
Yeah, just how basically, so Dana White and his wife get into like in Cabo at New Year's Eve. And then, you know, he apologizes. Right. She talks about it, whatever. But it really hasn't garnered any media attention. And then there was one of the reporters or personality, I don't know what you call them, from ESPN was like, hey, like, this, there's kind of a party line,
right?
And don't mess up the $1.5 billion relationship with the UFC and how nobody's talking about it.
That's interesting. Yeah, I mean, look, ESPN is conflicted all over the place. You see with every, you know, NFL, NBA, and now obviously UFC.
It's hard when you have a rights deal.
Yeah.
It's hard when you have a rights deal.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it gets complicated. And yeah, you know, you didn't see that much from the Dana White thing on a large, you know, institutional level, but certainly a lot on the Twitter side of the backlash to it.
Yeah.
And, you know, certainly, you know, one big reported story on it could be more
things.
Trouble for
Yeah, for
that.
Sure. Anything else you're watching that you think people should know about?
Watching? That's interesting. I mean,
I'm thinking about.
I think so.
Like, what do you think happens with Substack?
So I was almost going to say Twitter. You know,
Twitter.
Because
yeah.
I think there's a bit of a love hate relationship between Substack and Twitter right now. But Kara Swisher tweeted this, and I actually think it might be true: is that could Twitter buy Substack and incorporate long form? And there's rumblings that they're going to start doing these like 2,000-word tweets, which just sounds daunting.
Yeah.
And I'd rather not do that. But it kind of sounds Substacky, you know, like doing a long blog post or something, incorporate audio and video more into it. I'm very interested to watch what happens with Twitter.
That's interesting.
And I think Substack could be part of that, but. I'm, you know, my feed is constantly changing. I feel like on Twitter, they're trying to make
TikTok. Do you go to For You or following? My head's like in a pretzel. I get on Twitter now, and I don't know which. Like,
I do both.
It's annoying to me, though. I don't
know.
What's the point of that?
It's, well, so, you know, For You is basically curated. Trying to be, yeah, TikTok, you know, and I think it was Pat from Out About who, uh-huh. who said that it felt like, you know, a TikTok feed for him, you know, where it was like serving this and a lot of video.
Taylor Lorenz, like every post. So I'm like, enough. What's that saying about, I don't know. I was like,
well, I don't get served that because she blocked me, so I can't.
All right.
Maybe
I need to try that.
You know, a lot of video, a lot of like, you know, viral images.
Yeah.
But I kind of like both. You know, I like to see what it thinks I want. And then I go and just
and
the chronological.
And see who you have.
Yeah. I'm interested in it. Look, Elon's like amazing and brilliant.
Yeah.
I mean, and he actually has started to, I think, pull himself away from like, you know, airing out all his stuff
on
Twitter.
Yeah, I think he was like, I've gone a little too far.
Yeah. Like, get down to work. Like, see what you can do to
who
fix
the business.
Who do you
think they hire as a CEO?
Yeah. I mean, the rumblings are that it's, you know, like that. I mean, I've heard of like the people that are current, you know, social media company CEOs or former ones, and you know, his friends at the All In podcast, those kind of things. I think it's more of someone who was either at Twitter or someone who previously was at Twitter. I mean, you know, Jack Dorsey's not going to do it, but Jack and Elon have a good relationship. Mm-hmm. I think you need someone who understands Twitter.
Yeah, the nuance of that product. Yeah,
and you don't want to make it this crazy splashy thing. Yeah. Make it someone who's smart and knows the product and just get down to work. I think it's interesting. They've got some momentum right now.
Hmm. All right, Steve, thank you so much. This was so great. All right, Athletic Brewing. So this is Athletic Brewing. Cute can, looks like a beer, isn't a beer. It's new year, new you, right? Everybody's trying to get skinnier, eat better, stick to their to-do list, make their resolutions. I spend a lot of time thinking about, gee, should I cut back on alcohol? I think most people think, gee, should I cut back on alcohol? And the answer probably is yes. So this January, what Athletic Brewing wants you to do is to give Dry a try. So you're like, hey, I got to go to a party on Friday night, or hey, people are meeting up after work. You could enjoy a near beer with Athletic Brewing. Doesn't have a whole lot of calories, does taste great, and keeps you to your resolution of being dry this January. The other great thing is that they make like all sorts of flavors. So if you're like, the Penn people are all like IPA people. I've never met so many IPA people in my life, except like my family maybe. So anyways, like you like the IPAs, you want something that tastes like an IPA, you can get an IPA. You like a light beer, I'm kind of a light beer person, you can get a light beer. So they've got all sorts of flavors. You can give Dry a try this January. And new customers can receive 20% off their first order of 2 6-packs if you go to athleticbrewing.com and use code TOKENCEO. Got to check out by March 31st. So go to athleticbrewing.com, receive 20% off your first 2 6-packs, put in code TOKENCEO, and go have yourself some near beers between now and March 31st. And now we're doing Q&A. First question. How do you position yourself for a promotion starting a new year? I do not know if people's grammar is legitimately bad.
I
read these things and I'm just like, what the fuck? It might be because it's an Instagram. It's like mostly DMs and that format doesn't.
Yeah, sometimes I try to like reword them, but also sometimes I don't know if it's the right way to
Yeah, we don't want to fuck with what people want to say. Yeah. So anyway, shout out to everyone writing in. We're so appreciative. We may make fun of your grammar, but... How do you position yourself for a promotion? Clearly, this person wants a promotion now in the new year. So how do you position yourself for a promotion? I would say you should do a couple things. One is use the, like, everybody wants to be like a goody two shoes, like brown nosery beginning of the year, to set a meeting with your manager or your boss to say, hey, here's all of my goals for this year. I want to accomplish this number of things. I really want to make a difference in doing blank. I want to make such and such better. And I want to finally help resolve this gnarly, not talked about, elephant in the room problem that's been plaguing your group, right? Whatever that may be. Set the meeting with your boss. Lay out all of those goals that you have for this year. Lay out a vision for really the job you want, not just the job you have. Make sure the list of things you want to accomplish kind of include the things that you would do if you had a promotion, and leave it at that. So I don't think any manager really appreciates at the beginning of the year, like somebody coming in and pounding on their desk and saying, I want a promotion. I think what managers appreciate is someone who comes in and is like, I'm going to make this job better. I'm going to make this place better.
I'm going to make your life better, and I'm going to make our company better. Like, that's what managers want to hear. So I think if you do those things, you'll be super well positioned for a promotion. I think it's probably appropriate, you know, a month into the year, a quarter into the year, to say, hey, I've accomplished a lot of these things I've been working on. I really am eager to grow my career and advance my skill set and my knowledge, and to expand my level and scope of responsibility. What's the best way to go about earning a promotion? I think the phrase earning a promotion is really important. I think sometimes people demand promotions, which I find unattractive. And then I think they also, it just seems petty and small. Like, really, who gives a shit about the title? What you want is more responsibility. What you want is more pressure. And really what you want is more opportunity. So that's how I would ask for it. All right, second, how do you shake PTSD from a toxic work environment so that you can thrive in your new job, so that you don't sabotage yourself in your new role? Ooh, this is a good one. I actually have seen this a lot. I think there's a couple things. One is, if you're leaving a toxic job or a toxic company or a bad workplace, or frankly, just a bad situation which makes you feel badly about yourself. Whenever I leave a job and I feel about it, I try to sleep for like 3 days. Like, I just feel like you need that little bit of time to like mope and feel sorry for yourself and feel sad. Like, do you ever mope, Mackenzie?
Oh, definitely.
Are you a moper?
Not like big time. I try not to be, because then I overthink everything.
Yeah, I think like a little bit of moping is healthy. Do you know what I mean? You need the like 2 days of like being in your sweatpants and eating bad food and watching like shows that give you comfort, like Law and Order.
Yes.
If shit's going wrong in my life, I'm definitely watching Law and Order. So I think when you leave a toxic environment, you need to let yourself rest a little bit, and you need to let yourself feel the emotions and the sadness or the grief or the frustration or whatever, all those feelings that you have that you try to shove down and make sure nobody sees, let them like envelop you for a little bit. Don't do it for too long. I think it's like 3 days max, 72 hours. The second thing I try to do, and I don't know if this is good advice or not, but at least it works for me, is I try to write down, what is it that I liked about this last job? What did I find valuable? What did I like? What was I good at in this last job? And what didn't I like? And where did I go wrong? And what didn't I do as well as I could have? Where are the situations that I fell down? Like, I think the exercise of writing down the good stuff and the bad stuff that you're ashamed about, it kind of solidifies those two things. And then I think the third thing to write down is, what do you want from this new job? And don't make it 100 things, don't make it 10 things, make it 2 or 3 things of what do you want in this new job. And I think the process of like really dealing with your feelings of leaving, the second is articulating and kind of writing down and memorializing what was good and what was bad and what you learned. And then really setting your sights on what's next, it can be really, really important. You know, it's funny, I talked to my dad this morning on my walk to work, and my dad was like, we can only look forward. Like, it doesn't help you to look back. It doesn't help you to wallow in what was or what went wrong or what you could have done differently or what someone else should have done differently. Like, that doesn't help you, because you can't change any of that shit anyways. So I think looking forward is really important. So to do that, you got to let yourself have the feels of what went wrong. You got to be able to articulate those things and be crisp about it and honest. And then you got to set your sights on what's next. All right, last question. I'm in a constant mental dilemma of how much to work in order to succeed and live life. Oh my God, this person's like,
this
in my
one
head.
I definitely tried to like,
you got a little copy edit?
Yeah, but I still was unsure of the first line.
Okay, I'm in a constant mental dilemma of how much to work in order to succeed and live life. I wake up one morning and I'm super motivated about working a lot to move up the ranks and make good money, something that's super important to me and I value. And other days I'm like, why kill myself in this rat race when I should just enjoy life? This person is like literally living in my head right now. Any advice on how to make it in the world without being miserable and working all the time? Or is that just how it needs to be? Ooh, okay. First of all, I don't think work should be miserable. Maybe I'm a crazy person. I love to work. I love coming to work. I have definitely hated work. I've hated people I've worked for. I've hated the people I worked with. I've hated myself in so many jobs. I've hated the job itself. All those things I've left. So the first thing I would do is like abandon the premise that working a lot means you're unhappy and work equals misery. I think that I could have done a better job in my 20s and my 30s of working less and living life more and knowing myself better. Like that will be one of the regrets in my life, is that I just worked away my 20s and 30s. But I'm also, I don't think I would be here if I didn't work away my 20s and 30s. And I do think at the end of the day, I really loved my work. Like I loved work. Even the bad experiences, I loved learning from them. So the first thing is like working a lot doesn't mean you're miserable. The second thing is you don't have to work all the time to succeed. I think you have to work hard. I think you have to be open to learning. I think you have to be self-critical. I think you have to be motivated and show initiative. I think one of the hardest things right now at work is just people don't have initiative. I don't know what is happening to people. Like, I don't know if being on Zoom all the time just like makes you feel like you're disconnected and you can't Zoom in or live in or lean in. Like, you gotta have initiative. But you don't have to have it one way entirely or the other way. Like, I believe that you can have a great job that you work hard at, that fulfills you, and you can have a great life. Or you can have a great life that fulfills you, that you enjoy, that you relish, and that you immerse yourself in, and you can have a great job. So the two aren't mutually exclusive. I think you gotta kind of meter yourself and understand what's really important to you in life. What do you wanna make time for? What do you wanna have time for? Where do you wanna be? Like, what are the things that are sacred? And then you can also do the same thing for work. What do you really want out of your job? If work equates to being miserable, I think you're in the wrong job or the wrong industry or the wrong field or the wrong discipline or something. And so maybe that's the first place to start. All right, that wasn't so bad. That's it. Thank you for listening. We'll see you back here on Thursday. We've got great merch coming up. I'm actually excited about the merch. So for anybody who listens to this and likes our merch, we've got good stuff coming. And we'll see you back here Thursday.